Hello dear student, today we will start a new chapter, a new unit, unit number 6 of first year physics, which is about fluid dynamics. So there are certain topics which are excluded in your smart syllabus from this chapter. So the topic we will study in this chapter are viscous fluid, Stokes law and terminal velocity, fluid flow and equation of continuity. So these four topics are included in your small syllabus. So this is very much interesting chapter. So first of all, let me define fluid. What do you mean by fluid? Fluid are anything which have the ability to flow. That is called fluid. Fluid may be liquid, fluid may be a gas. And the fluid dynamics is the branch of physics in which we study about fluid in motion. This is fluid dynamics. So the first topic from your smart syllabus is viscous fluid or viscosity. So dear student, viscosity is the characteristics of fluid related to thickness of the fluid. We have seen water, we have seen honey, we have seen glycerin, and if we throw a cup of or a glass of water, it will move to some distance far away. But however, if we throw a cup of honey, it will not reach to that point to which the water reaches. What does it mean? It means that honey is more viscous than water. So in simple word, we can define viscosity as the resistance of a body different layer of fluid to its flow is called viscosity. If we define it, viscosity is what? The resistance of a different layers of fluid to its flow is called viscosity. So dear student, fluid which flow easily have low viscosity, while fluid which flow slowly has high viscosity. So the resistance offered by the different layers of fluid to its own flow, that is called viscosity of the fluid. To give a quantitative shape or to properly derived an expression for viscosity or coefficient of viscosity, we have to understand the velocity gradient first. What do you mean by velocity gradient? Velocity gradient. Say suppose we have a solid surface like this. This is a solid surface. And some fluid is flowing on this surface. So there are different layers of fluid. Say suppose this is the first layer of fluid, in which the fluid flow with velocity V1. This is the velocity in the first layer of fluid. Now due to the pressure of fluid, the second layer of fluid will have velocity greater than this first layer of fluid. It will move to some more distance like this. This velocity will be greater than V1. Say suppose this is V2. Now what if we go to the third layer of fluid? The third layer of fluid will have velocity greater than the second layer of fluid, and it will be represented by V3. Also, let me draw some other layer. Fourth layer of fluid will have velocity greater than this third layer, and this will be represented by V4, V5, V6 and so on. So what do you mean by velocity gradient? Velocity gradient is the increase in velocity per unit length. We say that due to pressure, layer 2 has more velocity than layer 1. V2 will be greater than V1. Similarly, When we go up, the velocity go on increasing and have to take a measurement at that point. When we go in upward direction like this, what will happen? The velocity will go on increasing and we have to take a measurement at this point. Let x be the distance, and at distance x the velocity of fluid will be v. Say suppose here in this case we reach to v3. v3 will be equal to what? v2 minus v1. Well, sorry, v3 will be equal to v3 minus v1. This one, v3 minus v1. Or simply we can say that if we go to a unit length, this increase in velocity per unit length will be equal to what? Velocity gradient. So velocity gradient is simply defined as increase in velocity per unit length. What is the definition of velocity gradient? Increase in velocity per unit length. Is velocity gradient, it is given by v divided by x. Now, dear student, after velocity gradient, we have to calculate the expression or sufficient or proper formula for the coefficient of viscosity. Like this, that force per unit area, which is pressure, force per unit area will be equal to this velocity gradient. Increase in velocity per unit length, because when we move it upward direction, the fourth gear will have greater velocity than the third gear, and the fluid flowing in the fifth gear will have greater velocity in the fourth gear, and so on. So by going in upward direction, the velocity of the fluid increase. So the pressure is equal to velocity gradient. Pressure is directly proportional to the velocity gradient. Now to divide the sign of proportionality, we use a constant. If divided by A is equal to eta, this constant eta V divided by X. Where eta is a constant, which is given by F divided by A upon V divided by X. Eta is a constant which is called what? Coefficient of viscosity. Eta is a constant and known as coefficient of viscosity. Eta is coefficient of viscosity, which is equal to, from this formula we can define coefficient of viscosity as the pressure required which will create a velocity gradient of 1 per second. Eta is coefficient of viscosity and is equal to what? F divided by A. We can also say in other terms that F divided by A is stress and V divided by X is strain. So this is the stress to strain ratio in fluid, not in solid. So eta is coefficient of viscosity and is equal to the pressure required which will create a velocity gradient of 1 second, which will create a velocity gradient of what? Of 1 per second. Dear students, this per second is the unit of velocity gradient. From here, we know that what is the velocity unit of velocity gradient. The unit of velocity gradient is per second. Like this, we can calculate the unit of velocity from this equation. What is the unit of velocity meter per second? Meter per second. What is the unit of distance? This x is height. This is meter. So meter cancel. So the unit of velocity gradient is per second. Now the coefficient of viscosity is equal to the pressure required, which will create a velocity gradient of 1 second per second. If this is equal to per second, and if divided by A is the pressure, so it is the pressure which creates a velocity gradient of how much? 1 second. From this formula, V divided by x for water is greater, so viscosity, coefficient of viscosity of water will be less. Similarly, V divided by x, which is velocity gradient, is less, is less for honey or for viscous material. So if V divided by x is less for honey is compared to water, what will happen? The coefficient of viscosity of honey will be greater than that of water. So that was all about the coefficient of viscosity. What will be the unit of coefficient of viscosity? Here let me write the unit for coefficient of viscosity. Unit for coefficient of viscosity we can write from this formula, eta equal to F divided by A. What is the unit of force? Newton. The unit of area is meter, so Newton per meter. And the unit of velocity gradient are V divided by x equal to per second. So Newton per meter divided by per second. If this divided by per second come here, so it will be equal to second. So Newton per meter into second is the unit for coefficient of viscosity. But this is not the SI unit. The SI, this was derived by a scientist, Paisley. So Paisley gave Paisley entitled the unit of coefficient of viscosity by his own name. So its other unit is Paisley. Paisley, which is shortcut, can be written as Pais. Pais is the CGS unit of coefficient of viscosity in centimeter gram second system. The unit of coefficient of viscosity is Pais. The SI unit of coefficient of viscosity is what? SI unit of coefficient of viscosity is Pas. P-A-S. This is equal to 10 Pais. 1 Pas equal to 10 Pais. So this is the relationship between CGS and the SI unit of coefficient of viscosity. Dear student, let me summarize briefly this once again. We have studied about viscosity, which is the property related to the thickness of fluid, and to derive a proper formula for viscosity, we have to understand velocity gradient. Velocity gradient is the increase in velocity per unit length. This is per unit length. Increase in velocity per unit length or per unit height is called velocity gradient. This velocity gradient is given by V divided by x, where V is velocity of the fluid at a particular layer and x is the distance from this solid surface. Here at this surface the velocity of fluid is equal to zero at this surface, because this surface is at rest. When we go in upward direction, the first layer will have velocity greater than this surface molecules, the second layer will have velocity greater than this first layer, and the third layer will have velocity greater than second layer, and so on. So by this velocity gradient, we can define the coefficient of viscosity as pressure is directly related to the velocity gradient, and there we use a constant eta. This eta is called coefficient of viscosity, which is equal to the pressure required, which will create a velocity gradient of 1 per second. This will be equal to coefficient of viscosity. So, dear student, after that, with reference to this viscosity, we have another law which is known as Stokes' law. After that, we have to discuss about Stokes' law. Stokes gave a law for the spherical object. When an object is falling through a fluid, which force, how much force will be experienced by that object? That force was first determined by Stokes, so therefore that is called Stokes' law. So let me explain the Stokes' law. Stokes theorem or Stokes' law. Stokes' law. Dear student, you know that when raindrop fall through the air, atmospheric air, the air will oppose the motion of the raindrop. Similarly, if an iron ball is dropped in glycerin or honey, the motion of this iron ball will oppose by this glycerin or honey and will experience some force. This force was first determined by Stokes. According to the Stokes' law, this force will be directly proportional to what? Coefficient of viscosity. The more the viscous, if the fluid is more viscous, it will experience more force to the motion of a spherical object. Also, this is directly proportional to what? Radius of the sphere. For greater object, for a big object, this viscous drag force, this is if we call viscous drag or drag force. This drag force for small object will be less, and for a big object this drag force will be greater. Similarly, this drag force is also directly proportional to velocity. The greater the velocity, the greater will be the drag force experienced by the object. So by combining all these, we get that drag force is directly proportional to eta r v. Eta is the coefficient of viscosity, r is the radius of a spherical droplet or spherical object, and v is the velocity. So by combining all these, we get drag force is equal to 6 pi. 6 pi is the experimental value of constant, which will must put be here to get the proper formula for drag force. So if d equal to 6 pi eta v, this expression is stated as Stokes' law. You can see that the greater object or the big object will experience greater drag force, and the small object will experience less drag force. So consider a particular example. Let me have a fluid and a small spherical body flowing through it like this. Consider we have a fluid like this, says over this is a, here is a fluid, it may be atmospheric air, it may be water, it may be glycerin or honey or any fluid. And we have a small spherical object having weight mg. The weight of this small object mg is in downward direction. Say suppose initially its velocity is zero, so the drag force on this object is also zero. Now when it falls through that fluid, this fluid will experience an opposing force. This will apply an opposing force on this drag object, but the body will still accelerate from zero velocity. Say suppose at this point, what happened? At this point, the weight of the body is mg, which will not change, but the body will experience some drag force in opposite direction. Now, after certain time, the weight of the body is still mg, but let's say at this point the drag force become equal. This is Fd. Drag force become equal to the weight of the body at a particular velocity. At that velocity, when the drag force become equal to the weight of the body, we say that the net force in this case is zero. When the net force is zero, what will happen? Acceleration will terminate. So when acceleration is terminate, mean when the net force is zero, acceleration will be zero. When acceleration is zero, the body do not stop. The body will move with certain constant velocity, which is called what? Terminal velocity. This will become Vt. So the body will moving with Vt here, Vt here. It will be a constant velocity, which is known as terminal velocity. So in this case, when the net force, if net force on the body becomes zero, let me write here, if net force on the body is equal to zero, then what will happen? If net force is equal to drag force or mg minus drag force, when this net force is zero, we will get mg minus fd, or we can also say that fd is equal to mg. Drag force is equal to mg if net force is equal to zero. It means that acceleration is what? Terminated. When acceleration is terminated, the velocity will call terminal velocity. That particular velocity will call terminal velocity. So here we know that Fd equal to 6 pi eta r v equal to mg. So we can say that this V is Vt, terminal Vt is equal to mg divided by 6 pi eta into r. This is the expression for calculating terminal velocity of a small spherical object which is falling vertically down to the through the fluid. So from this formula, we can define terminal velocity as the constant maximum velocity of an object falling vertically downward. Terminal velocity is the maximum constant velocity of an object falling vertically downward through a fluid, falling downward, falling vertically downward true absolute. For which what's happened? Drag force become equal to the weight of the body. For which drag force become equal to what? Weight of the body. As we can write it, mg. So this particular velocity is known as terminal velocity. Now here from this expression we can see that if the fluid is more viscous, if the coefficient of viscosity of fluid is greater, terminal velocity of fluid will be smaller, because coefficient of viscosity of fluid is inversely related to what? The terminal velocity. What about R? Here you can see that R is also inversely proportional to the terminal velocity, but in real this is not the case. We have to derive a relationship between radius of the object and terminal velocity. So how can we derive the relationship between radius and terminal velocity? Here let me derive this particular relationship. From this formula, if we say that R is inversely proportional to terminal velocity, generally you can see that if R is small, from this formula terminal velocity will increase, but this is not the case. When R is small, the object will achieve terminal velocity very soon, here at this extent. But by increasing the radius, matlab big object, for example, big object will have a greater terminal velocity. How it will derive relationship? Relation between what? Terminal velocity R V T and the radius of spherical body. Spherical droplet. Say suppose we are talking about the drop of iron drops. So we know by formula that rho or density is equal to what? Mass per unit volume. And from this we get, this implies that mass is equal to rho into V. So putting this value of M in this equation, we get terminal velocity Vt is equal to rho into volume, this is G, divided by 6 pi eta into R. Now what is the volume for spherical object? We want to establish a relationship between terminal velocity and radius. So what is the volume of spherical object? So spherical object, spherical object has volume equal to 4 divided by 3 pi r cube. This is the value for what? Volume of spherical object. Putting the value of V here, we get terminal velocity is equal to rho, which is density, and V is equal to 4 divided by 3 pi r cube multiplied by this g divided by 6 pi eta into R. So in this expression, here are certain cancellation, means this will become 2 and this will become 3. Pi will cancel with pi, this is R, will cancel with R square, R cube, we will get R square. So we get a new expression, a new formula for terminal velocity is let me write it here. The formula for terminal velocity will become Vt is equal to Vt is equal to 2 rho r square g, 2 rho r square g divided by 3 3 multiplied by 3, so 3 3s are 9, and 5 is cancelled with this 5, so 9, this is mu, coefficient of viscosity is not cancelled, 5 is cancelled with 5, so 3 3s are 9, this is eta, 9 eta, so rearranging this equation, we get terminal velocity equal to 2 rho g r square divided by 9 eta. So from this expression, we can see the terminal velocity of the body is directly proportional to the square of the radius, r square. It means that, what does this mean? This means that by doubling the radius of the object, terminal velocity will increase how much? 4 times. If you drop a small droplet here, a small iron ball, say suppose here, its terminal velocity will it will achieve a particular a terminal velocity at a particular point. But if we increase the radius of the object, that it will achieve the terminal velocity later on, after its smaller. So from this expression, it is clear that terminal velocity, the greater the radius of the object, the greater will be its terminal velocity. So that was all about terminal velocity in Stokes' law. So dear student, hope that it might be clear to all of you. Inshallah, in next lecture, we will discuss about the remaining topics of this chapter. Hope that it might be clear. It is enough for today, and goodbye.
Number 1, first.